so much
for coming.
Oh, here we go.
Welcome. Thank you so much for coming. Just a couple of housekeeping things. First of all, some of you I don't know yet, but I will know you really well by probably the end of August. So I'm Kathy Peters. Officially, my title is Director of Junior High Academics and Advising. My more informal title is Mom to the 7th and the 8th grade. And here comes my partner in crime, Vicki Bransford, who is Dean of Students for the Junior High, who graciously offered to be here with me tonight. So if I get off track, she'll jump in and help out. So a couple of things. The slideshow that was playing when you came in, that was our 7th grade trip to Savannah that we just returned from. If you are the parent of a 7th grader, if you go to Walmart Photo, the login is my email, kathy.peters@htes.org, and the password is HTTigers in all caps. You can get any of the pictures that you would like to have. There are even more than were in the slideshow. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, if you want to take pictures of any of the slides tonight, that is perfectly fine with me, because I know it's hard to remember all of this. If you want to take pictures, please feel free to do so. If you have not yet read this book, I strongly suggest that you read it. The book is How to Raise an Adult, and it's by Julie Lithcott-Haynes. It was our book selection when we did the curriculum, when we do the parent book talks. It's an excellent book for anybody who is parenting a junior high student getting ready to look at a high school. I have a 30-year-old and a 27-year-old, and I read this book for the first time 2 years ago, and I was like, gosh, I wish I knew that when they were 12, 13, 14. So strongly recommend that you read this. Handouts. We had a lot of handouts. Clearly, we're not in high school yet, so we're really not ready to take AP classes. But as I told Fisher's dad, I like you all to be very well informed. So when your child comes home and says, Mom, I think I'm going to get the AP capstone diploma, you have information. So you can say, well, really, did you know that blah, 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 blah. So I like you to have plenty of information. I also think it helps if you can look at potential schedules when you're looking at your child's classes. So those are the purposes of the handouts. Hopefully you got everything you needed. If not, please let us know, and we'll be happy to make more copies.
She goes, you want to say a quick hello. This really isn't my comfort zone, but like she said, I'm Vicki Bransford. I am the dean for junior high. I've been at Holy Trinity for 22 years. I've been the athletic director, I've been a PE teacher, and now I'm in charge of your children when they do great things, and when they might not do great things, they get to come see me as well. But she and I love what we do, and we love the children that God places in our care, and we surround them, and we love them, and we get them through the good times and the hard times. So we're glad to see you all here tonight.
The other thing I would like to say is, if you have a question while I'm talking, please raise your hand and go ahead and ask it, because I know it's hard to remember. I'm going to try to keep this to about 40 minutes if I can, so I'll go pretty fast. The other and most important thing that I want to tell you is, none of the information on this is a one-time thing. You're going to hear a lot of this again and again. Some of it's not going to even be relevant to you right now. Like when I say AP class, you're thinking, I just want my child to remember to take his notebook to his classes. And I get that. That's where a lot of us are living. So don't feel like you'll never hear any of this again. So I'm blessed to be working with all of these people. We have a cadre of people who work on advising your students. So you can see how this works. Your students will work with me to plan their 7th grade, 8th grade, and 9th grade classes. In the 9th grade, I pass them off to Mrs. Ramos, but generally, I know them pretty well. So sometimes we co-advise them. If you want to sit down with her, we do it together. But pretty much, like, I'm working with my 8th graders now, getting ready to send them off to high school after having had them for 2 years, which is pretty hard. So that's how we're structured in the college counseling department. Our goals for junior high, and we have them, would be these. To strive for balance in academic and personal life. Balance is a word that I really want you to think about. It doesn't do much good if your child takes every single AP class, if they don't have time to rest or breathe or do their hobbies or those things. So academics are very important, but being a balanced person and having hobbies and sports and other things we like to do is also important. To pursue and develop areas of interest and passion. When we were in Washington, D.C., we discovered that two of our 8th graders were unbelievable ice skaters. We didn't know that, because clearly we don't have that much ice in Florida. So those are things that they are passionate and excited about. As a result of that, one of the young ladies has organized an ice skating group. They've been ice skating 3 times, a little group of people that now ice skate. So one of the things that we want to see happen is, what are you excited about? Maybe it's math, maybe it's science, maybe it's basketball. But we want to nurture those things when they're in junior high. We work very hard to do that.
By the way, jump in anytime if you want to say something.
Also, not only are we a school that develops their academic talents, we also want them to know about their athletic abilities. Even if they have a lifelong sport, they realize, I'm going to be a walker. Every day I'm going to get out and exercise and walk. I'm going to learn to play tennis. That's something I can do for my entire life. Morally and socially, that's also very, very important in the junior high. So much of what Vicky and I do together is help them work on problem solving and figure out a better way or a better solution. This is what you chose to do this time. What might you choose to do next time? And how did that work out? And last, to become self-advocating, responsible, self-directed, and intrinsically motivated young people. Raise your hand if you would like to go to college with your child. No hands are up. Oh, one. Okay, we got one. Okay. Most of us don't, so we have to work really hard to make sure that they are able to make independent decisions, feel good about advocating for themselves. I spend a lot of time talking to junior high students about, okay, you don't think you did very well on that science test, what are we going to do? After we finish crying in my office about the science test, then what plan do we have? Okay, now you have to go talk to your teacher. We practice having conversations about how to talk to a teacher. These are all things that they have to develop when they're in junior high school. And lastly, self-efficacy. Very important. Those are great two words to think about. So, welcome to the seventh grade families. I love seventh graders. They want to do everything correctly. They are very, in fact, they will remind me of the rules at time, or they will tell me when it's B week or C week, because they are very focused on doing everything exactly correctly. It's overwhelming, okay? The first few days of school, they have 7 teachers, 7 people that they have to be responsible to. I remember a few years, more than a few years ago, a young man came up to me in the hall and said, are you my English teacher or my social studies teacher? I said, well, I'm actually your English teacher. He said, oh, we were all blonde, so I couldn't remember. That's where he was living right then, all these blonde people telling me what to do. So it is overwhelming. Seventh graders work very, very hard to meet everybody's expectations. Like I said, they're studying the rules and they want to please them. Not only do they want to please all of us, they also, more than anything else, want to please all of you. Generally, if someone comes to my office or Mrs. Fransford's office, the first thing they will say, if something hasn't gone well, my parents are going to kill me, will be so upset with me, will tell me I have to work at McDonald's. So their first thought is making you happy and pleasing you. In the junior high years, friends become very, very important. What their friends think will be more important than what I think or what you think. We just had NJHS applications due. Some people didn't turn one in because their friends said that was a bad idea. You are gasping in horror at that, but that's the degree to which friends can become that important. And lastly, we love this. These are showing out new interests in new personas. It can be very entertaining for you because all of a sudden they'll have a passionate interest in rock climbing or something like that. But that's a good thing. That means they're trying to figure out who they are. It can be challenging, but that's what should be happening in that first year in junior high. Eighth graders, a little different, a little more stress. They're either taking their first or additional high school credit classes. So people are constantly telling them, this will appear on your high school transcript. And they're like, I don't even know what a high school transcript is, but apparently it's a bad thing. But so they're a lot more concerned about that. You'll notice they become more responsible and more independent. And Mrs. Bransford and I often talk about, okay, not so much helping, you know, they need to learn to figure these things out for themselves, because in high school, a greater degree of independence is expected. Their friendships change, their interests change. We had a group of young ladies that were absolutely sure they couldn't room together in Washington, D.C., so we said, okay, we fixed it. Long story short, we went to the trip in Washington. Guess who was hanging around together the entire time? Them, because a month had gone by. It happens. There's a lot more drama. Okay, I keep special boxes of Kleenex and chocolate in my office just for eighth grade girls, just so you know. There is definitely an increased interest in the opposite sex, which can cause its own challenges. If the person I was going out with suddenly breaks up with me before my algebra test, that's not going to go well. So there's a lot of that that goes on as well. And eighth graders push boundaries. It's just what they do. They're the top of the heap in junior high, so there's a little bit more of that experimenting. So to move on to academics, which is really why you are here, this year is a different year for us. We have done a lot of looking very hard at our curriculum, at our expectations, and what we as a school are asking of our students. One thing we want to do, one, is make sure that we're in line with what's happening nationally. Secondly, what's happening with other Episcopal schools and other independent schools. So in October of this year, Mrs. G selected some people to serve on what we call the ARC committee, which is the Academic Review Committee, and then invited other people to join. This committee has just completed looking at our academic requirements, our daily schedule, and student time and stress. And we have made some changes, which I'm going to talk about in the next few minutes. Once we made the recommendations, we presented them to Dr. Cobb. Dr. Cobb made some suggestions to us, we tweaked the things, and then these were all presented to the board for review, and these changes have been approved by the board. They are going to impact your students, so we're going to spend a few minutes talking about them. You can find all of this information that I'm going to talk about and more in our curriculum guide. It's online on our website. If you are a brand new to Holy Trinity parent, you won't have access to it yet, but you will. If you are a current parent, it looks like this. You can find it under the Student Resources tab, and everything I'm going to talk about is going to be there. All of our curriculum policies, our grading scale, our requirements, all of the courses that we offer, whether a course has a prerequisite, a co-requisite, all that information is there. And that would be a great thing to look at before you start talking about scheduling with your child. So our curriculum has shifted just a bit. If you have an older student, you probably know that we formerly required 20 age credits to graduate. If you look at the bottom, now it's 25. We still require 4 years of math in high school. You have to take math every year. We require 4 years of English. But now, for science, you can take 3 or 4 science classes. Or for social studies, you can take 3 or 4 social studies classes, which is great. If I am passionate about science, I have a chance now to take another science class, or vice versa. If I'm passionate about social studies, I have the option to take another social studies class. So when we looked at our requirements, what we're trying to do is not make it easier, but make it more individualized, to allow our students a little bit of latitude to take the things that they want to take. We have also reduced the required elective requirements to allow them some freedom in taking some of the things that they wanted to take as well. You'll notice it doesn't add up to 25 because we didn't put the elective hours there since there's some freedom there. So to graduate from high school, in science, they now have to take biology, chemistry, or physics instead of biology, chemistry, and physics. Most of our students are still going to take physics. Most colleges want to see physics on the transcript, so most of them will still take it. For social studies, they are required to take only US History and Gov Econ. In their 10th grade year, they have the choice to take an elective, and it doesn't have to be a social studies elective. In the 9th grade, they're required to take World Civilizations, or if they're a stronger student, they can take AP World History now as 9th graders. Okay? Every Holy Trinity student is required to take 3 credits of world language. That did not change. Hopefully, they will start a language in their 7th or 8th grade year and take it 7th, 8th, 9th grade, 9th, 10th, 11th grade, and even farther. Hopefully you all had a chance to meet Mr. Mize. He was here tonight to talk about the Latin program. But what we require is 2 consecutive years in the language. So if I take Spanish 1, I should take Spanish 2. If I'm not that excited about Spanish, I can take Spanish 1, Latin 1, Latin 2, and then I'm ready to graduate. As you'll see a little later, all of our languages are offered through the AP level. What we hope is the student will get excited about a language and take it all the way through to that level. Students are required to take 1 year of fine art in the high school, starting in 9th grade, and they're also required to take a half a credit of religion in the high school. Their health and physical education requirement, that required credit, they meet that in the 8th grade. All of our 8th graders take a class called Hope and PE, and that meets that graduation requirement. I'll stop for a second in case you want to take a picture, in case you want to ask me questions. So if you have a student who's taking Algebra 1 honors right now, that is a high school credit class, so they have already started on that track. If they're taking Spanish, French, Latin, those classes are also high school credit classes. Gabrielle. asking?
Yeah.
So if you weren't here for eighth grade and you did not take Hope PE for us, so you came in ninth grade,
yeah,
you still have to take, if you don't play a varsity sport for us, you still have to take a half a PE credit from us. But no matter if you're playing sports for us and you're here in eighth grade, you still have to take Hope and PE.
Got it.
So another adjustment that we made is in our community service or our service learning. Probably, maybe you're not familiar with this yet, but for the Bright Futures program, service learning is required as a part of that program. We looked at the hours that we require of our students, and we have decided that 100 hours is completely reasonable. So we have reduced that by 20 hours for our students, which means 25 hours per year of attendance. For those hours begin to count towards graduation the summer after eighth grade. So as soon as someone finishes the eighth grade, they can start accruing hours. We also participate in the Presidential Volunteer Service Award, so you can start accruing those hours as a seventh or eighth grader, and we have a chance to keep track of those as well. Chaplain Jared is really passionate about community service, and he wants to work on getting the students involved in something that they stay involved in for the entire time that they're here, not just 3 hours here, 2 hours there, 4 hours there. Question?
What is the Bright Futures Award?
The Bright Futures?
75 for medallion and 100 for ISA.
Okay, so still meeting.
We exceeded it before, but yes. Oh no, we wouldn't have made it any lower than that. Florida Academic Scholar, sorry.
Thank you, though. 75 for the minimum and 100 for the top for the medallion. So there's two levels of Bright Futures, so 75 and then 100. Okay, are we good? Thank you, Beth. Another thing we adjusted is our grading scale. So when any college looks at your student's GPA, they are going to do whatever they would like to do with those grades and that GPA. They're gonna look at the courses, they're gonna decide which courses they want to include, and they're gonna calculate the GPA however they would like to calculate it. But one thing that we have noticed, we use now what's called the Common App, which is something that's pretty standard throughout high schools, and the Common App, the scale is a 4.0 scale. Formerly, we had the A+ at the top of our scale, which gave us a 4.33 scale. That was not beneficial to our students because they had to continuously recalculate their GPA as they were applying to colleges. So this just streamlines and simplifies the whole process and puts what we're doing more in line with what colleges expect and what other people are doing. Want to add anything else to that? If you don't know, Mrs. McHenry also, you saw her name on the list, she works in the college office.
I'm going to have a newbie next year, too. I'm back to seventh grade. It just gives them a more realistic look at their GPA. It's not slightly inflated. I'm speaking out of turn there, but like Ms. Peter said, it's just keeping it in line with colleges. It makes it much easier, more realistic, and much easier for filling out the Common App, which most of them will do.
Still give the 0.5 additional credit for honors classes and the 1.0 for AP classes. As you can see that the weighting is still there. All we've done is adjust the very top so there is no more A+. It kind of reduces the stress on our students as well because an A is still an A. And let's be satisfied with that, you have an A. You still know that if you have a 99, you are way near the top of the scale. Many schools, and we opted not to do this, have an AP criteria. You can only take one course, you can only take two, you can only take three. We didn't want to do that. Instead, we decided that we would craft our AP philosophy. So I'm not going to read the entire thing to you. I'll let you look at that and you can take pictures. What I do want you to look is the bottom, is our philosophy is, and I will read that part. Most students will graduate with 3 to 5 AP classes, with the majority of those courses scheduled during their junior and senior years. Students may choose a more rigorous AP schedule that may include a maximum of 1 AP class as a freshman, 2 as a sophomore, 3 as a junior, and 4 as a senior. Every year, students work with their advisors to plan their program. So we didn't want to write something that was set in stone, because there may be students that say, hey, I really want to do this, I want to do that. So, but this is kind of our philosophy for you to look at. This is what we feel is appropriate. Every year, we add new courses or we change courses. Most of these are courses that our high school students would take, but I think it's exciting for you to see that you're not, your students are not entering a stagnant curriculum. Every year, we have teachers that are excited that say, hey, I would like to teach this class, I would like to do that. We joke that Dr. Booth, who is our psychology teacher, needs to start his own department because he has so many courses that he would like to teach. But I think that's a really exciting thing. It'll be fun as the students start selecting their courses to see which of these courses actually run. We have two new junior high classes, and these will definitely be things that your students will look at, so I'm gonna talk about them. First, we're gonna offer Quiet Study. Quiet Study is something that we're offering across the grade levels. There'll be a 7th and 8th grade Quiet Study, a 9th and 10th grade Quiet Study, and an 11th and 12th grade Quiet Study. Those are not for credit classes. It's simply a study hall. Students can opt to take that, and they will go to that class. There will be a teacher monitoring the class. Students can work on homework, tests, study for tests, work on projects, make up work that they've missed when they were absent. We have academic coaches in the junior high. This will be a perfect opportunity for our math coach or our organizational writing coach to pull a student and work with them for a few minutes. I think Quiet Study is ideal for a student that has a rigorous outside life. They play on a comp team, they love piano, they ride horseback, they do something like that, and they need that little bit of breathing room. Also, for a student who wants to take two or more challenging classes, it would be a benefit to have this opportunity to work on some homework. So, it's an option. Our second one, and this class, we're always looking, junior high students need to move. They just need to be able to move. Many of our students learn kinesthetically or tactilely through using their bodies, so we're offering a class called Mind and Movement. It's going to, as it says, help students to develop techniques to manage stress and quiet their minds to be able to focus a bit better through using physical movement and physical activity. So you're going to hear a lot about the level of a class, so I just briefly wanted to talk about that. In junior high, our classes are offered at the advanced level or the standard level. If you look at our courses, you'll see that many of them have the prefix M/J. That stands for middle or junior high school. So, for example, Mr. Dowling teaches MJ World Geography Advanced. That's a middle junior high school class offered at the advanced level. Ms. Pershnick teaches MJ English 3. That is a standard English class offered to 8th graders. She also teaches MJ English 3 Advanced. So junior high classes, advanced level, standard level. When you move to the high school, classes are offered at the college prep level, the honors level, and the advanced placement level. For those of you who don't know, an advanced placement class is a college level course that's offered on a high school campus. The reading, writing, and testing load is similar to what you would expect to find in a college class, and those classes require that a student take the advanced placement test at the conclusion of the course. Why would you want to do that? Many colleges give college credit for the completion of those classes. It's also a great chance for our older students to really experience a challenge and a rigor in a particular area. You wouldn't want to take 6 or 7 AP classes. What you would want to do is think about something that you're passionate about. Say you love history, you might want to take those history electives in AP. Or you might love science and you want to take AP chemistry or AP biology or AP physics. Eighth grade core classes. Our eighth graders, our four core academic classes are offered at the advanced and the standard level. All of our eighth graders take English, history, some level of math, and physical science. So recommendations for those classes have been made by the teachers. Your students can't see them yet, but they will be able to see them on their retreat day, which is March the 27th. You won't be able to see them because they show up on your students' login, but they can log in and show you what the recommendations are. A recommendation is exactly that, where the teacher feels the child will perform the best. If you feel differently, that's something that we ought to have a conversation about. One thing I do want to mention, when we were working on our science curriculum, in the past, physical science was an honors or regular level credit class. It's now a junior high school class. We felt that we could do better having that class be a junior high class and putting some more rigor into the advanced class rather than give high school credit for that class. So now both of the junior high science classes are not high school credit. Eighth graders all also take the HOPE PE class that I was talking about, and then they can select two electives, preferably a fine art elective and an academic elective. And I just wanted to point out that HOPE PE is a high school credit class. All seventh graders take the same core curriculum: advanced English, advanced life science, world geography advanced, seventh grade PE, and most of them test into pre-algebra, pre-algebra advanced, or algebra one honors. We do have a few seventh graders this year who are in geometry honors. As you all probably all know, our math testing for seventh grade is on April the 27th at 9 o'clock. Right here at Holy Trinity. And after that testing is done, we'll look at those test results, we'll look at teacher recommendations and other placement tests. Then you as a parent will get a letter stating what the math placement is for next year. And again, that's also something that's under discussion. Suppose your child tests into Algebra 1 honors and you're thinking, no, that's not something we want to do. You can opt to have your child take pre-algebra advanced. So we can certainly talk about that as well. So in addition to their five core classes, seventh graders also take two electives, preferably one fine art and one academic, or two fine arts, if that is something that they are excited about. We really need to, for seventh graders in particular, look at the rigor of their entire day. A seventh grader who has placed into Algebra 1 honors and has opted to start their foreign language, that's a pretty heavy duty schedule. So that's something that you ought to think about as a parent and that we probably ought to talk about. To be successful in foreign language, doesn't matter what grade you're in, you need to be very comfortable in English writing and English grammar. And sometimes we think that foreign languages, oh, I can count to 20 in Spanish, I know my colors, I know my numbers. No, they're conjugating verbs. Someone has me help them with their Spanish homework last week. They're in Spanish 1. I had to think about the preterite tense. I haven't worked on that in a while, so it is challenging. So if you're thinking about foreign language, really think about that. Many of them are ready for it, but it is a high school credit class and it is rigorous. So the junior high fine art electives for next year will be Art Survey, which is the entry-level art class, Advanced Art Survey, and both of these art classes will include introductory visual graphics so that students will be prepared to take computer graphics in the high school. So there'll be some graphic art in both of the classes. Percussion, band, choir, orchestra, and acting. Band, choir, and orchestra are all offered from the beginning level. I have never picked up an instrument in my life, all the way to I've been playing my saxophone for 5 years. And what happens is your student would select band, choir, or orchestra as their option, and then the instructor would get in touch with you, you talk about what they have done. Sometimes they come in and they play for an audition for proper placement as well. But seventh graders can play in our wind ensemble, which is the top level of band. So our academic electives for junior high, for foreign language, we offer French, Spanish, and Latin. As I mentioned, our two new classes are Quiet Study and Mind and Movement. We also have Introduction to Computer Programming, and then Robotics and Engineering. Robotics and Engineering are both semester classes, so a student would take a semester of robotics and then move to a semester of engineering, or vice versa. So high school credit classes that you take in the junior high, they do appear on your student's transcript that we sent to colleges, but they're not calculated in their Holy Trinity GPA. The GPA clock, so to speak, starts running in the ninth grade. So if your child wants to take Spanish or French and they're excited about it, please don't have a panic attack and think, oh no, you might get a C and that will wreck your chances of ever getting into college. No, because we're not going to calculate. A college will look at that, but that's not going to get calculated into their GPA. Most colleges focus primarily on their grades in 10th and 11th grade, 9th through 12th, but mostly 10th and 11th. So don't be concerned about that. Let's say your child takes a high school level class like Spanish or Latin and decides, oh no, this was a bit much for me. They can be withdrawn from the class. What will be on their transcript is a W. So we have these amazing flowcharts for all of our academic disciplines. You can find these in the curriculum guide that I was talking about, and you can see that if someone's coming here as a seventh grader in that college prep row that we talked about, they're probably going to start off in pre-algebra. In that honors row, probably pre-algebra advanced. And we even have math electives. Who knew? Oh boy. Now, there are those black lines between college prep and honors AP. Those are not lines that you cannot cross. Someone who is in pre-algebra and knocks it out of the park can be recommended for Algebra 1 honors the next year. Someone who's in Algebra 1 honors that's really struggling could be recommended to go to geometry. These are things that are discussed with the teacher throughout the year, and I will tell you, our teachers are fabulous communicators. You're gonna know when someone is either doing amazingly well or having a bit of trouble in their recommended level. Math is the place where hard and fast scores determine it. You know, to be in an honors math class, you really need to be testing up at the 90% level, and to be recommended for honors math, you need to pretty much be able to hold your test scores at that 85% test level. English. All seventh graders start off in advanced English. Right now, my seventh grade English teacher has recommended to me who needs to go to regular English, who ought to go to advanced English. And you can see that most students move to either English 1 or English 1 honors. Notice what happens in the 10th grade. There's no more college prep English. Everyone takes either English 2 honors, or they have the option to begin their AP classes by taking AP seminar, and that's a special diploma that we'll talk about in just a couple of minutes. Science, and you can see the change there that I talked about. Seventh graders go from life science advanced to physical science advanced. And technology and engineering are also part of our science curriculum. You can see up at the top, well, we don't have it here, but above where it says technology engineering, our junior high robotics and computer programming classes would be there, and that they feed into those high school classes. Social studies. Notice now in both the college prep and the AP, there's that space for elective, and it doesn't say social studies elective. That 10th grade year is now their elective year, so if somebody's wildly excited about science, they could put a science elective there, so there are a lot of things they could do with that one space. Here are the religion courses that we offer. This you don't have to worry about until your student is starting in 9th grade, but just so you can kind of know. And usually we offer ethics during the summer. So somebody who has successfully completed 8th grade and has a lot of ideas about what they want to put in their schedule can take this requirement as a summer class at Holy Trinity. It pretty much takes up the whole of the month of June, but they can get that half credit done in that month, which is nice because a lot of my students have a lot of electives they can take. A new class that we offered, you probably saw it listed before, was the Cross of Christ. Chaplain Jared teaches both the ethics class and the Cross of Christ. Mr. Mize, who you met outside, who is our classics teacher, teaches the ancient Greece and Rome class. A lot of students have him for Latin 1 and like him so much that they decide to take ancient Greece and Rome just for that reason. Ancient Greece and Rome is a great class because it meets the religion requirement, but it's also a social studies class. So here are our world language classes. A new class that we added that's been really popular has been the Spanish language through film class. It's a fun elective class. This is a department that your students really won't hear too much about until they get to the 9th grade. The 9th grade class that students can take is that Introduction to Journalism class, and you can see that feeds both into our yearbook program, our broadcast program, which is the student news broadcast that the students see once a week, and our newspaper program. Hopefully you have seen a copy of our Growl, which is a student-produced newspaper this year. It's pretty amazing. And last, with the prize for biggest flowchart of all, is our fine arts department. And you can see that goes in a lot of different directions. I just met with an eighth grader going into ninth grade today, and she's all excited because she's going to take computer graphics and photography. She's a very artsy person. And you can see where our junior high course is there. And notice that all of these classes are going all the way to the portfolio and AP level as well, for those of you students who really love art. Graphics, ceramics, art and design, which is really drawing and painting, and then photography. Last are performing arts, acting. In the high school, the acting is the introduction to acting class, advanced acting, and then musical theater. And I already talked about the orchestra, band, percussion, and choir. Our last department, personal and physical development. These are the classes offered at the high school level. So if you have a student who would be so sad that there is no more PE in his or her day, they can continue to take PE as an elective class in the high school. A lot, it's not required, but they can take it. Many students pair their ethics class or their religion half credit with a PE class, because that's something that they like to do. We encourage our students, our 9th and 10th graders, to take their religion requirement and their fine arts requirement in the 9th grade. When you have been here a little longer and you're looking at the electives, or when you're looking at the curriculum guide, you'll see that many of the electives are offered to 10th, 11th, and 12th graders. So if you get your requirements done as a 9th and 10th grader, one, you know a little bit more about what you're really interested in, and two, you have room in your schedule to take some of those classes. Okay, Holy Trinity has some diploma specializations. There was a handout about the AP Capstone diploma, and you probably saw our little banner that we're an AP Capstone school. So in order to qualify for that diploma, and that is a nationally recognized diploma, not just a Holy Trinity diploma, you have to take two courses, AP Capstone Seminar, which as you saw in the flowchart, can be taken as your 10th grade English class if you choose to. Then after completing that class successfully, you would need to take AP Research, which is not an English class, but an elective class. So you'd still take 11th or 12th grade English in this class as an elective. And then you need to take four other AP classes by the time you reach your senior year. And you have to have a score of 3 or higher on all of those end of course AP exams. Just so you know, the scale is up to 5, so 3 is doable. So that is a rigorous diploma, but it's something that many of our students strive for. The joy in that is AP Seminar and AP Research are not typical English classes. They're taught very differently. They teach students how to explore a topic in depth, really do research and present that research, which is very similar to what has to be done in many college classes. The other two diplomas that we have are Holy Trinity specific diplomas. I believe I had the sheets for those for you to take a look at them. I would not say, if your child is interested already in one of these paths, the STEM STEAM diploma is for students that are strongly interested in math and science, and the Global Citizenship is for students that are more interested in language and social science. If your student has a passion for one of those areas already, I would say it's worth looking at the diploma requirements and letting your child just add that out as another feather in their cap. But you wouldn't want to really tell your child, okay, you're gonna get this diploma, so you have to take these classes. Both of these diplomas require coursework, and you can see the list of classes that students have to take. And then they also require that students participate in different projects, co-curricular activities, or do an internship or a study abroad trip. So there are some additional requirements. Why would you want to do something like this? Remember that starting in the 7th grade, you are trying to help your child create a profile or a picture of themselves. So when a college is looking at 200 applications, there's something special or unique about your child. Any way that you can individualize or make your child stand out, and these are three of the ways that you could do it. Okay, so how do we decide what classes we're going to take? For current 7th graders, that's going to be done through on campus. They will have their retreat day with me on March the 28th. When they're with me, I'm going to present something similar to this, talk about the requirements, what they should take, what they need to take. And then they will be able to log in, and I will walk them through the course request process, and they can request their classes. Before it's final, you can certainly take a look at it. I would start talking to them in advance about what do you think you're going to sign up for, what do you want to take. So their requests are due on March the 31st, but there is plenty of opportunity for us to sit down about what they have and talk about what they have chosen to take and make changes all the way up through the first week of school. For current sixth graders, they will receive all of their information on April 27th when they're here for the math placement test, and their requests are going to be due on May the 3rd. But again, advice and appointments can continue. I'm going to be at the lower school just for questions and to talk about advising on Monday, May the 6th, in the gallery from 7:45 to 8:15, in case you've looked at this and thought, I don't know, you know, what would be better, but I will be there in case you want to ask questions. And you are also welcome to email me and say, hey, can we come up and sit down and talk with you from an advising appointment? I'm happy to do that. So for seventh graders, for math and elective course selections, they will take the math placement test on the 27th. And after we've reviewed all the data, looked at the test scores and everything else, you will get a letter telling you what their math placement is going to be. For their electives, after the presentation and the math placement testing on the 27th, I'm going to email you a Google form, and you will complete that Google form and tell me what two electives they want to take and alternate electives. And then again, like I said, you can email me and we can do an advising appointment if you like. So this is what, for my current seventh graders, this is what their course request, this is what their page is going to look like. So you can see that this person has a recommendation over here. They've been recommended for pre-calculus with AP Calculus A. And the way they'll select their classes is right on the little arrow. They will click on English, and then the classes that they can select from drop down. Most seventh graders now have a recommendation for English, for science, and math. I've looked through them and I've seen those. One thing I think that's the hallmark of junior high is the support that we give to our students, and I had our little card out there in case you took one. All of our teachers have office hours. We have a math lab at the upper school that students can go to, and we also have academic coaching throughout the day for our junior high students. We have a math coach, Carol Carr, and a writing and organizational coach, writing, reading and organizational coach, Karen Roach, who are available to your students. So testing, because this is something that everybody starts to worry about. So at Holy Trinity, our 9th, 10th, and 11th graders all take the PSAT in October. For our 9th graders, we just say, okay, here's what the test is, here's what it's going to measure. We just want you to take a look at it and do your best. For our 10th graders, we say, okay, here's how you did the last time. What are we going to do differently? We have, you'll get a lot of information. They will get information as well about using Khan Academy, plugging their test results into Khan Academy, and being able to study directly and specifically from their test scores to work on their weaknesses. And the 11th grade year is the year that the PSAT really counts. So they will have taken it twice by the time they take it for the year that counts. In the spring retreat, and Mrs. Ramos just finished doing that with our 10th graders, every 10th grader at Holy Trinity takes a practice ACT. The tests are sent away at score, the students get the results, so they already have an idea on how they're going to do on the ACT before they actually take it. And then we recommend that students take the actual SAT and the ACT beginning in the spring of their 11th grade year and beyond. So if you're thinking about all those big and scary tests, when should you start taking them? There you go. So a couple of things about summer. I mentioned the ethics course, so if you happen to have an older student who has already completed the 8th grade, these are the dates for the ethics course that will be offered this summer for our religion graduation requirement. In case you're thinking, oh, they could drop in for two of the weeks, no. If you're going to get a semester worth of credit for it, you have to be here every day. We also offer our math lab over the summer, and I strongly encourage you to consider sending your students to math lab. Math is one of those things that you have to practice all the time. Mrs. Ramos, and I love the way she says this, we call math lab, it's like a gym membership. You sign up for one of the sessions, you can go every single day, all day, or you can go 2 days a week, or you can go an hour each day. It should fit your schedule. Because what happens is you do an assessment at the beginning of the session, that assessment tells you the things that you need to work on, the skills you should work on, and then you work on those at your own pace if the instructor is there, and there are a couple of high school students also there helping out usually. So definitely one or two of the math lab sessions would be great. Our summer brochure will be available online soon, so you can look at the other things that we have. We offer in winter, at the end of February, in winter break, we offer a micro term. We offer classes that you can get a quarter of a credit for. Just try something that you're wildly interested in. We do the same thing at the end of session in the spring, a week of classes, and that those classes and offerings will be available. Also, if your student is coming to seventh grade next year, I strongly encourage that they would come to Junior High 101. That'll be July the 22nd through the 26th. From 9 to 12 every day, they get to spend a whole week with Mrs. Bransford and I. They get their course schedules, they get their lockers. Most importantly to them, they meet all the other people they'll be going to seventh grade with. Other things to do this summer. If you are vacationing near a college campus, go and walk around the college campus with your students so they can start to see what colleges look like. Many of them don't have a concept of what a college looks like except their basketball gym or their football field, possibly. There are other things on college campuses, so that would be a good thing to go do. I always tell seventh graders to do an excellent job on their summer reading. Our summer reading list will be available online probably by about April 20th. Open a Khan Academy account and look around. There are tremendous resources available for free. Their SAT prep on Khan Academy is phenomenal. Just take a look at it yourself. You might even be motivated to go take the SAT again. It's so good. They also have great support in math, in writing, all kinds of things. Students respond really well to Khan Academy because much of it is visual. They can watch the person working out the problems. They're very different than other resources, and it's free. It's amazing. The other thing that's great to do is when you have family gatherings, have them start interviewing people in your family. Where did you go to college? What do you study? What do you like about your job? What do you do at your job? They need to start developing that idea of what adults do all day and why they like it and why they don't like it. And lastly, because they're going to have to do service learning, start getting involved in doing things as a family if you're not doing that already. So then they get the idea that, okay, service learning is something, it's not just I have to do it so I graduate, it's something that we care about and we do as a family. Hopefully I have not put you on information overload. One thing that's really important to us, as a staff, as a college counseling advising staff, we work really hard to make sure that you have the information that you need. There's no question that's too small. It was great that Bev was sitting here when I wasn't sure about that answer to Bright Futures. I don't mind saying, I don't really know because I know that I can find someone. So I don't want you to feel that way either. Feel free that you can come ask us questions. Especially, and even better, send your students to talk to us and ask questions. If you can help them make a list of students, of questions, send them and say, now you have to go talk to Mrs. Peters. Or make an appointment and meet with your advisor to talk about, this is big stuff, you know, the class. We want them to be happy and excited about the classes that they're taking. I think I'm done. So I have time for questions if you have general questions or if you want to stay and talk to me. Thank you, Mr. Chair, that means good. Question. We're not going to offer skills for success. Can we find out, plan with that, what's best for junior high students? We had an academic prep class where they had writing and then they had study hall, rather than worship hall. Skills for success, what they like best about it was the opportunity to do their homework. So we think we can still get the benefits of the coaching and then and give them the homework. So yeah, we did get. The other class we're not offering to eighth graders is the writing support class. This past year, eighth graders could take writing enrichment. That didn't work so well either. They wanted to work on their homework, so we have that option. Other questions? So my child takes the math placement test, and the test says they should be placed in Algebra 1 honors. So if they decide not to do it, Algebra 1 honors is a high school class. In Brevard County, ninth graders take Algebra 1 honors. When students transfer to us, many of ninth graders who come to us from outside are in Algebra 1 honors because that's how the sequencing goes outside of Holy Trinity.
So that's the first thing you should think about. Is my student ready for that work? I don't think you're missing out on anything. What you really want to think about, in my opinion, in terms of math, are they ready to handle abstract thinking? To be successful in algebra, you have to be able to hold abstract concepts in your brain, sequence them, and remember them. There are some seventh graders that are prepared to do that, but there's no rush. If you look at that math flowchart, multivariable calculus equates to the third year of calculus in college. Do we really have to get that far? So.
They do get the credit for it, or they do take it?
They get the credit for it.
Mm-hmm.
They do.
What they're doing
is speeding up their math progression. But there are other ways to do that. Honestly, if you're like, oh, I don't know, I would really strongly encourage you to come in. That's a one-to-one conversation that I have. So I can tell you, here are the reasons why you should do it, here are the reasons why you shouldn't.
I have another question.
Sure.
Can you say something about AP classes?
Mm-hmm.
Is there a basic requirement for them to graduate that has to take for them that number of classes?
No. Well, we offer 28, but I wouldn't suggest you try to do all 28. I think our, and remember, philosophy as opposed to must and should, is that in something that you're excited about, you should pursue that discipline to the highest extent that we offer the classes. Like, if you love biology, you should be taking all of our life science-related classes. You should take AP biology. If you are not a history person and you just don't like it, you're probably not going to take an AP history class. You'll be miserable. That's our way of looking at it. Probably everybody should take an AP class so they can experience that rigor. The question is, when are we ready to start that? So his question was, like, should I be, pick my elective right away? No, since we offer classes in sections, we can offer another section of that. Like, if 60 people suddenly wanted to take robotics, we should be able to look and say, gosh, we need to open another section of that. We do limit how many people we put in robotics and engineering because they need workstations, so we discovered 16 is a good number for a class. But if we needed to offer another section, we would certainly try. All I know around a little bit, in case you want to ask me a private question, you should have my card with my email on it. Thank you so much for coming and listening to me for forever. I'll never talk this much again, I promise. Thank you.